Dear students, welcome to EPG Pathshala. I am Professor P. Bhaskar Reddy, Department of Ancient Indian History, Culture and Archaeology, Sri Venkateswara University, Tirupati. In the present module of the paper, Outlines of Indian History, you are going to learn about India under the crown. In the previous module, we have discussed the 1857 revolt. The result of the 1857 revolt is the end of company's rule and the transfer of power from company to crown. Further, the revolt of 1857 gave a serious jolt to the British administration in India and made reorganization is inevitable. The government of India's structure and policies underwent several changes in the course of time. Hence, the present module is designed to discuss the transfer of power from company to crown, the frontier problems and the policies, particularly with Afghan and Burma, the native and princely states and British policies towards the native states, the administration under the crown and its main features, the policies and the resultant consequences of the age. With these objectives, let us start our discussion on the transfer of power from company to crown and its main features. Regarding the transfer of power is concerned, the British crown's rule over India began in 1858 and ended in 1947. The transfer of authority from company to British crown was done under the Government of India Act of 1858. The governance of India was passed from the hands of the company to the crown, assisted by the Secretary of State and the India Council. The Secretary of State was a member of British Cabinet and as such was responsible to British Parliament. In India, the Governor General was to be the personal representative of the British crown. He was given the title of Viceroy. Lord Canning was the first Viceroy of India. The change was formally announced by the Queen's Proclamation of November 1, 1858, which set forth a new policy for India. The Queen's Proclamation committed the Government of India to a policy of greater respect for Indian usages and customs and of non-interference with religious beliefs and worship. With that aims and objectives, the policy of doctrine of lapse introduced by Dalhousie was discontinued. The Indian Council's Act of 1867 enlarged the Governor General's Council for the purpose of making laws, in which capacity it was known as Imperial Legislative Council. During the tenure of Canning, members of this council were given responsibility for specific departments. In India, for the first time, the provision was made for the nomination of non-official members to the Imperial Legislative Council. The power of legislation was restored in the presidencies of Madras and Bombay. The judicial system was also significantly altered to suit the needs of the local conditions. Accordingly, the Indian Penal Code 1860, the Code of Criminal Procedure 1861, and the High Court Act of 1861 were introduced. During the Crown period, from 1858 to 1905, the India was governed by 9 viceroys between Canning and Curzon. Among that, the important viceroys are Lord Canning, Lord John Lawrence, Lord Mayo, Lord Lytton, Lord Ripon, Lord Dufferin. The last but not the least of these 9 were Lord Curzon, 1889 to 1905. It is known that the consolidation of British rule in India reached its highest point under Curzon's administration. With this discussion on the transfer of power from company to crown and the important setup of administration in India, now we may shift our discussion to another topic, the frontier policy of the Britishers, particularly towards the Afghan. By 1858, the British could establish their authority over the entire Indian subcontinent. In Northwest, the stability of the frontier depended upon understanding between British India and Afghanistan. This in turn depended upon Persia and Russia. In the year 1855, Dalhousie concluded a treaty of friendship with Dost Muhammad, the Amir of Afghanistan, and helped him to foil a Persian attack on Herat. This was the first interference of the Britishers in the internal matters of the Afghanistan. Dost Muhammad's death in 1863 led to the struggle for succession in Afghanistan. The government of India at the time maintained neutrality in this matter. Finally, in the year 1868, Sher Ali was successful in the struggle. The British, after this, recognized Sher Ali as the new Amir. When the Britishers recognized Sher Ali as the Amir, the Russia, instead of recognizing him, advanced into Central Asia. Thus, rivalry was begun between Russia and the Britishers to dominate over the Afghanistan area. Bukhara was occupied. In 1866, the province of Russian Turkestan was created in the next year. Samarkand was occupied consequently. Khiva was taken in the year 1873. Naturally, the British could not keep quiet when the Russians started this type of inroads into the Afghanistan area. England asked Russia to recognize Sher Ali's rights in Central Asia. When in 1876, the Russians intervened in the Balkans, British occupied Quetta, which was under the possession of the Russians. At the time, the Viceroy Lytton proposed to send an envoy to Kabul, but the Amir refused to accept the envoy. As a result, the British invaded Afghanistan in the year 1878. This was known in the history as Second Afghan War. Finally, the Treaty of Gandamak converted Afghanistan into an almost protected state of British India, but it could not be implemented due to people's movements in Afghanistan. Thus, the attempt of the English received setback. Once again, in the year 1880, Viceroy Ripon recognized Abdul Rahman, the nephew of Sher Ali, as the Amir of Kabul, on condition that he should have no political relations with any foreign country except the British. The British could get confirmation of Khurram, Pishin and Sibi given to them in the year 1879. Abdur could wipe out all his rivals with British help in the year 1881. Russia, which was not happy with the situation, occupied Merv in 1884, Pandeh, and threatened Zulfikar Pass. Finally, an agreement was concluded among the trio, British, Russia, and Afghanistan in 1887. They fixed the boundaries between Russia and Afghanistan. A line of demarcation between Afghanistan and India was drawn. It was known as Durandalen in the year 1893 and 1895. Even after the conclusion of that treaty and the drawing of Durandalen, the problem of relation between Afghanistan and Britishers not yet solved, because the problem of dealing with the tribals on the eastern side of New Line became a major frontier problem of the British India. This was finally solved by Curzon by creating Northwestern Frontier Province in the year 1901 and making its administration as imperial responsibility. However, the First World War and the Russian Revolution of 1917 created a new situation in Anglo-Afghan relations. The Afghans now demanded a full independence from British control. Amanullah, the new Amir of the Afghanistan, with an intention to get his independence, declared open war on British India in 1919. Finally, a peace came in 1921 when the Treaty of Afghanistan recovered its independence in foreign affairs. Thus, the Britishers followed a peculiar policy towards the Afghanistan because of the interference of Russians in the internal matters and to dominate over each other. It was finally came to very peace in the beginnings of 20th century. With this discussion, now we may shift our discussion to another problem of the British, that is the frontier problem of Burma and its policy. It is known that before 1857, two Anglo-Burmese war were fought. These wars had given the British an opportunity to occupy Burma's coastal province of Arakan, Pegu and Tenasim, thereby denying Upper Burma access to the sea. But the English traders were allowed to trade in Upper Burma. They got rights by the treaties of 1862 and 1867 during the time of Crown. They even permitted by the King Mindon and his successor Thiba to open overland trade with China through Burma. Later, the emergence of French Empire in Indochina in the year 1884 had treaty with Burma in the next year threatened British interest in Burma. During this period, heavy fine was also imposed on the Bombay-Burma Trading Corporation by the Burmese government. The British were intensively jealous of the growing French influence in Burma. Thus, the British, to make a contract, invaded Burma on 13th November 1885. The King Thiba surrendered in this attempt. All this forced the Viceroy Dufferin to annex Upper Burma once again in 1886. After the First World War, a vigorous national movement arose in Burma. The Kingdom of Siam was recognized in 1893 as a buffer state between the British and the French spheres of influence. With the discussion on the Crown's frontier policies with Afghanistan and Burma, now we are able to understand the main features, course, intervenes, and final results. Similarly, the Crown also followed a peculiar policy during the later course, particularly with princely states of India. Now, we may discuss the British policy towards the princely states in India and its main features. Regarding the princely states, the Queen's proclamation abandoned the policy of annexation. The doctrine of lapse was repudiated. The princes were assured continuous enjoyment of their treaty rights as usual, which they held in company rule. The right of adaptation was allowed on the condition of loyalty to the crown. The crown became the unquestioned ruler and paramount power in all India. The theory of one charge enunciated by Canning meant that India constituted one political unit comprising both the British possessions and the native Indian states. This is an important feature in the alignment of rule in India between the crown and the princely states. The native states, as a result, became protected states of British. There was a direct political intervention in case of misgovernment in any state of the princes. The British resident stationed in the native states exercised great influence over the internal administration of these states. There was a pressure on these states to modernize their administration, their technology, and so on. During the viceroyship of Lord Mayo, he founded the Chief's College at Ajmer, Lahore, Rajkot, and other places to encourage education of the princes and modernize. This facilitated the princes of India to improve their knowledge and also administrative matters. The imperial service corps formed by Dufferin built up a close association of the states with the Indian armed forces. In the year 1876, Queen Victoria assumed the title of Empress of India to emphasize British sovereignty over the entire Indian subcontinent. During the time of Lord Curzon, he made it clear that The princes ruled over their states merely as agents of the British crown. This was an important policy where Karjan was responsible for making a monopoly over all Indian territories. The princes during his time accepted the subordinate position and willingly became junior partners. The British government not only concentrated on gaining the power over the native states and also maintaining relations with the princes, and at the same time they contributed for the development of India in several ways. Particularly, they developed all India railways, postal and telegraph systems, currency and a common economic life in all sections of the society. Through the Indian Divans, the administration of the states was improved and popular representative institutions were introduced. Thus, the British crown during their tenure, they established different policies from the beginning and frequently changed depend upon the circumstances. By the beginning of the 20th century, and we know that the British has became sovereign masters in India. With this discussion, now we may shift our concentration on administrative structure of the British in India during this period. New features began to appear in the administrative system of British India. The Secretary of State of India was given enormous powers. In India, the Act of 1858 provided that the Governor General would have an executive council whose members were to act as heads of different departments and as his official advisors. Under that act, Governor General was given the title of Viceroy. The Viceroy was to work under the direction of the Home Government. The company's administration in India was subjected to periodic scrutiny through inquiries instituted by the British Parliament. With this establishment of central administration, the British government also allowed the Indians in the administrative matters. Particularly during the Keynes period, the Indian element was introduced in central administration. The Maharaja of Patiala, the Raja of Varanasi, and Sir Dinakar Rao were nominated to the Imperial Legislative Council, and changes were introduced by the Act of 1861. The Indian Council's Acts of 1892 added 10 more members to the Legislative Council. Out of them, 4 were to be elected by provincial legislators. The latter were enlarged by adding 15 to 20 members representing the local bodies like municipalities, district boards, chambers of commerce, and universities. During the time of Ripon, he also attempted some more changes in the structure of the local governments and their incorporation. He extended the system of further in the year 1882 by setting up local committees for the subdivisions of districts and for municipalities. The Indian participation in the administration had a limit. This is evident by the agitation over the Hilbert Bill. Under the Act of 1873, the British subjects in the districts could be tried only by European magistrates. In 1883, the Hilbert Bill sought to empower India's sessions judges to try Europeans only. Because of that, vigorous agitation by the Europeans forced the government to amend the bill, giving the Europeans the right to claim a jury, half of which were to be Europeans. Coming to the finance and economic policy is concerned under the British crown, the government could overcome the financial difficulties caused by the revolt of 1857. They raised loans in 1867 to finance irrigation projects and the construction of railways. In the year 1870, the provinces were given fixed yearly grants in addition to permitting them to raise funds through local cesses. The import duties levied on coarse cotton cloth were abolished, and also the import duty of 5% was reimposed due to the currency crisis in the year 1894. Due to the protest from Lancashire, a countervailing exercise duty of 5% on cotton goods manufactured in Indian mills was imposed. The most outstanding economic achievement of the period was the expansion of the railways by 1900. Nearly 40,234 kilometers were laid during this particular period, particularly during the time of Karjan. The railways helped industrialization of India and a great deal in fighting famines by facilitating quick transport of food from the surplus areas. During this period, several famines were occurred in Orissa, Uttar Pradesh, Punjab, Rajputana and Bihar. The government evolved a policy in the form of Finance Code of 1883. It recommended the creation of a special fund for providing relief and employment in the famine affected areas, and also urged utilization of railway facilities for the transportation of grain from unaffected areas. The overall impact of these policies are the disruption of traditional economy, ruin of artisan and craftsmen, impoverishment of peasantry, ruin of old zamindars and rise of new landlordism, stagnation and determination of agriculture, development of modern industries, poverty and finance. Coming to the education policy of the British are concerned, the Britishers showed special interest in improving the educational institutions, imparting the Western education, and also as a consequence they established several colleges and schools, which it resulted the promotion of Western ideas, scientific and also modern system of education, which all these paved the way for the national awakening in India in the course of time. Regarding the national awakening is concerned, in 1876, Surendranath Banerjee founded the Indian Association in Calcutta mainly to plead for the admission of Indians to the civil services. It also carried on campaign against the Army Act and the Vernacular Press Act of Lord Lytton. In the year 1883, as already said, the Gilbert Association led to the formation of Indian National Conference at Calcutta. In the year 1887, it shaped the establishment of Indian National Congress in Bombay. The Congress at first, it is known that they confined to passing of resolutions, criticizing various government policies and urging reforms. With the coming of Karjan in the year 1899, the national movement took a new turn, which we can discuss in the next chapters. So far, we have discussed several features of the transferation of power from company to crown, the policies of the British towards the frontier and Indian states, and also administrative setup, impact of the economy and others. But the discussion may not complete without a special discussion on the role of Karjan and its administrative policies, which is very important to know. Karjan was the Viceroy of India between 1899 and 1905. He came to India with strong and preconceived ideas. As a Viceroy, Karjan had a clear-cut knowledge about the task he had to do as the ruler. From the very beginning of his career, he was convinced of the necessity and the urgency of a thorough reforms of the entire administrative machinery of the crown. With that aims and objectives, Karjan, after becoming a Viceroy, appointed an expert commission to probe into the working of department and then enacted necessary legislation. He believed in strong centralized government and a powerful bureaucracy than the earlier. In the domestic front is concerned, Karjan reformed and reorganized the Indian police in 1902. He also appointed a police commission under the presidentship of Sir Andrew Fraser. He reorganized the Second Delhi Darbar in 1903. Karjan also contributed for the development of India. He passed legislations regarding the famines, land revenues, irrigation, agriculture, railways, taxation, and currency. No doubt that Curzon took several measures to improve the condition of peasants and also in solving their problems. By the Punjab Land Allocation Act of 1900, he tried to protect the peasants against conviction by the money lenders. By the Land Resolution of 1902, he lightened the burden of taxes on the peasants. He also encouraged credit societies and agricultural banks, opened the Department of Agriculture and the Agriculture Research Institute. Famine Commission was appointed under the presidency of Sir Anthony Macdonald. The Department of Commerce and Industry was also created. The Indian Coinage and Paper Currency Act of 1899 was introduced. A new railroad of 9,650 kilometers was built during his period. With the construction of this type of large-scale railroads, it resulted for the connection of various provinces and in the promotion of economic prosperity of the country. He passed the Ancient Monuments Preservation Act of 1904, and also this is meant to preserve the ancient monuments of India. Accordingly, the Director General of Archaeology was appointed under Sir John Marshall. He also established an imperial library in Calcutta. In the year 1902, he appointed an education commission to bring reforms in university education. Finally, it is known that he was responsible for the partition of Bengal in the year 1905, which it resulted for the origin of national movement in India from 1905 onwards. Though our discussion on the Crown's rule in India is in brief, which we highlighted only a few features to give a glance about the Crown's rule, the change of power, their policies, and also their administrative activities. In conclusion, the transfer of power from company to the crown, the frontier problems, the native princely states, and the crown's administration awakened the people of India and hastened the British struggle for independence from the British rule. For more details, please go through the e-text and other components. Thank you.